So what I want to do before I get into the details of recent developments is to talk about three different sources of paid holiday, because the distinction between them is important and it provides the context for some of the recent developments. So the first type of paid holiday that you need to be aware of is that comes from European law. So essentially, as part of European law, employers have to guarantee their employees 4 weeks paid holiday a year, which is equivalent to 20 days for a full-time employee. And that is inclusive of, and indeed everything I'm talking about today will be inclusive of bank holidays, okay? In addition to that, employers are obliged to give a further 1.6 weeks or a further 8 days for a full-time employee. And that derives from our domestic law, and essentially what the Labour government did a number of years ago is enhance the minimum period of holiday that was required under Europe. So what that means for UK employers is that they need to guarantee their employees a minimum of 5.6 weeks paid holiday a year, which is 28 days paid holiday for a full-time employee. Now, obviously, employers can go above and beyond that, and indeed many do. And there can be, in addition to that, a contractual entitlement, which could take it up to 35 days or whatever it might be. And that additional element is derived from contract. Now, the reason I've set out these three different types of holiday is essentially the developments in the cases that I'm going to be looking at concern the holiday that derives from European law, that 4 weeks. Now, just to summarise the position as it used to be before 2014, when we had a very relatively settled approach to holiday pay calculations, which has been overturned by a number of cases. The previous position used to be that if you had no normal working hours as an employee, then your holiday pay was calculated with reference to the previous 12 weeks. So essentially you'd look at what was actually received in terms of pay during that period of time, and that would then be used to calculate what you got paid when you then went off on holiday. If you had normal working hours, so you normally work, say, 40 hours a week, then generally the position used to be that you got basic pay only when you went on holiday. So you go on holiday for a week, you get your basic salary for that week, but you don't get the additional elements that you might otherwise have received had you been at work. For example, overtime or commission payments. And it's that aspect of holiday which has been repeatedly challenged. And this idea that employers can pay basic salary only to people with normal working hours. Now, as I say, there has been a suite of cases, and we don't have time here to run through all of them. All I've done is highlighted the three main areas which have been developed. And the first case I'd like to make mention of is the case of Williams and British Airways. And essentially this was all to do with contractual allowances. And this was decided under an aviation directive, but it has wider implications. And what that case found is that when you've got payments that are intrinsically linked to contractual duties or which relate to some sort of professional or personal status, then those allowances should be taken into account when calculating holiday pay. So it can't be basic salary only. You have to take into account those allowances that would have been earned had that individual been at work. You then had the case of Bear Scotland, and this is the overtime case. And so essentially this case found that where an employee is obliged to work overtime when the employer requests it, then that type of overtime should be taken into account when assessing holiday pay. And it also made clear that guaranteed overtime, so overtime that the employer actually says will be made available, again should be taken into account when assessing pay during periods of holiday. Now, what that case didn't go as far as doing is to talk about pure voluntary overtime. So overtime where the employee is not obliged to do it and does it purely of their own account. could that ever be taken into account when someone is on holiday? Essentially, we don't have a binding decision on that point as of yet, but the indications so far seem to be from some tribunal decisions is that actually voluntary overtime, particularly if it's worked regularly, could constitute part of someone's normal remuneration. And once it's part of normal remuneration, it then needs to be taken into account when someone's on holiday. So we've got a suite of cases there on overtime, which suggests that when someone is off on holiday, that sort of missed opportunity to earn overtime needs to be taken into account when assessing holiday pay. Now, the case I want to talk about in this webinar is the case of Lock and British Gas. Now, this is a commission case. And this is a Court of Appeal decision that came out towards the end of 2016. And it's recently been confirmed that it's not going to be appealed any further. So we have a final determination on this case. So just to explain and outline the facts of this case. Now, Mr. Locke was employed by British Gas and he received results-based commission. In essence, if he achieved a sale, then he would get paid commission on that sale. It was a contractual obligation, so as and when he secured those sales, British Gas was contractually obliged to pay that commission. And I believe it constituted a large part of Mr. Locke's remuneration, maybe around 60%. Now, Mr. Locke, when he went on holiday, was purely paid basic salary only. And all that he would receive in respect of commission is anything that just happened to fall in that holiday period. So in respect of those sales and those negotiations maybe that he'd been dealing with before he went on holiday, if that was secured while he was off, then he would receive commission for that period. But the problem for Mr. Locke was when he came back from that period of holiday, and essentially it was lower because obviously he'd been away, he hadn't been making his normal calls or setting up his sales meetings or whatever else he needed to do to secure those sales and secure that commission. And so he was financially disadvantaged because his commission was lower once he came back. Now, Mr. Locke wasn't very happy about this. And so essentially he brought a case against British Gas, which ultimately made its way to the European Court of Justice. And the European Court of Justice, in common with those earlier cases that we looked at, took a very similar line in that if these types of payments are not taken into account when someone is on holiday, then that is going to act as a deterrent to employees from taking the holiday which they are legally entitled to. And so what they said is commission payments do have to be taken into account. But that wasn't the end of the matter. And there were various questions that were sort of sent back from the European Court for our domestic courts to determine. And there were three of those. Firstly was this point as to whether our existing domestic legislation could be interpreted in line with the European directive. And the reason that's important is really to do with whether employers should be complying with this now, or actually there needs to be a further act of Parliament before they have to comply. There was also uncertainty about what types of commissions should be covered. And how do you calculate it? What reference period do you use? It's very easy to say that commission needs to be taken into account when someone's on holiday, but how do you actually do that? So this Lock and British Gas case ended up before the Court of Appeal. As I said earlier, we had a determination in the latter part of 2016. And what they found is, yes, results-based commission, like Mr. Locke's, needs to be taken into account when calculating holiday pay. What they made clear in that decision, though, was their decision was on this specific type of commission only. It was only on this sort of very much sales results-based commission. And they didn't expand that to suggest it may cover all types of commission. They refused to get drawn into that. And that creates a number of problem areas. There was no clarity as to whether maybe annual results-based bonuses needed to be taken into account. What about commission that is partly determined by individual sales and partly determined by company performance? Does that get taken into account? And also, what if there's a discretionary element? Mr. Locke's scheme was contractual. He was obliged to get that money from British Gas. What if there's an element of discretion in terms of whether or not that's paid? And the Court of Appeal essentially refused to expand beyond the circumstances of Mr. Locke's position to give any guidance on any of these areas. Now, there had been hope that this case would proceed up to the Supreme Court and there would be a Supreme Court decision that would give us much greater certainty. And I remember talking about this subject in January, and our hopes essentially of that have been dashed. And the Supreme Court has refused British Gas leave to appeal. And what that means is that this decision is now finalised. And we are stuck with the situation as it is and with the guidance, what guidance we have, in place. Now, what that means is that there is not going to be anytime soon much further court guidance on how employers should approach this issue. And certainly this Locke and British Gas decision is not going to be overturned anytime soon. So employers need to consider their position now. There's no way that they can delay it any further. A reminder that all of this stuff, we're talking about the 4 weeks leave that originates from Europe, not the additional 1.6 from domestic legislation and not any contractual holiday on top. And as I say, there's uncertainty about what reference period you use for commission during holiday. So the Advocate General in Europe suggested maybe you look back over 12 months. How much commission have they earned over a 12-month period? Average that down and pay it during a period of holiday. But that was just a recommendation. It's not binding. There's also been a suggestion you look at a 12-week period, which is what is currently used for employees with no normal working hours. And there's been a suggestion that maybe it's something else entirely. The only guidance we have is that it needs to be representative. And that can change from business to business, from industry to industry. So what do you need to be doing now? Well, firstly, you need to have a look at, in particular, your overtime commission and bonus payments. And if you haven't already got a good grip of it, you need to know exactly what is being paid to whom and to when. Because you can't start to think about holiday pay issues without knowing what is actually being paid out. What you then need to do is assess whether there are any holiday pay liabilities. Some of that might be historic, to look back to see whether you've done what you've needed to do in the past, and some of it's to look at what your working practices should be going forward. Once you've assessed that, and probably taken independent legal advice on whether or not those types of incentive payments, overtime payments, commission payments need to be taken into account, you may need to consider, are you going to alter your holiday pay calculations going forward? Now, you need to be quite careful with that, as if you start taking into account those payments now, are you implicitly accepting that you should have been doing that in the past? And also, if the situation or there was to be further cases decided in future, are you going to want to alter your arrangements again? So you need to be quite careful in terms of that, even if you're looking to do something which is to the advantage of your employees. The other thing you may need to consider a little bit wider than holiday pay is whether there's any need to change your working or pay arrangements more generally. So do you still want to be paying out so much in terms of overtime? Do you need to reconsider your bonus arrangements? Whatever you decide to do, you then will need to update your employment contracts to reflect essentially whatever you've agreed in terms of how you're going to calculate holiday pay. And also, you may want to, although it may prove to be more complicated than you'd wish, distinguish in between different types of holiday. So if this is creating a large financial liability that is going to cause you problems, then you may want to assess and calculate holiday pay in a different manner for the 4 weeks from the European legislation as you do to anything over and above that. So a few final points. The usual caveat, this is only sort of a very brief introductory summary to what's a quite complex area of law, and so you should obviously take legal advice on your own specific circumstances. Also highlight the legal updates that we provide by email on a regular basis, and indeed if you want details of future webinars, then please just email me and I'll send you across some examples to have a look at. Equally be delighted to hear with any feedback or suggestions for any further events. And there's my email address and my direct line, so please do get in touch. Lovely to hear from you. And if you haven't already checked out the other aspects of this seminar, then please do. There are three separate sections on employment status, general data protection regulations, and gender pay reporting.